In this video, we're looking at masks in Affinity Photo and how to use them. It expands on the layers video from the previous lesson in this course. If you didn't see that, I've included links to it and earlier lessons in the YouTube video information. Now to understand what masks are, let's look at a simple example by adding a black and white adjustment layer to this image. To do that, I'll use the icon at the bottom of the layers window. Then in the list, select the black and white option. I'll just close the dialog because I don't need that to explain how masks work. If we look at the Layer Studio panel, we can see the adjustment layer which has a white thumbnail. The white thumbnail represents a mask that's attached to the black and white adjustment layer and which controls where the layer's effect is seen. This mask has the same size and dimensions as the image document it's covering. When the mask is white, as this thumbnail shows, the mask has no effect on the adjustment layer. You can also switch to viewing the mask rather than the image. You can do this by holding down the Option key on your keyboard and then clicking the mask thumbnail. If you're using a Windows PC, that's the Alt key. Now you can see the mask is completely white. Let's use the rectangular marquee tool now to select a square in the center. When I then press Command and I on my keyboard, it inverts the selected area of the mask so that it's black. If you're using a Windows PC, you can press Control and I. To return to viewing the image rather than the mask, click the image layer once. Now you can see that the image is still black and white, apart from the center where I inverted the mask to black. What's happening is that a white mask allows you to see the effect of the adjustment layer, whilst black hides it. Where the adjustment layer is hidden or masked out, you just see the layer below, which is in color in this case. If I select the adjustment layer again and then invert the selected area of the mask, it changes that area back to being white and the color is gone from the image. Let's clear the rectangular selection so that I can show you something else. This time I'll invert the full mask so that the entire image is in color now because the mask is black and hiding the effect of the layer. Remember, press Option and click to view the mask. Let's select half of the mask using the rectangular marquee tool again. This time I'll use the flood fill tool to fill the selection with a light grey. Notice how the colour of the image in that area has returned, but it isn't so strong. What's happening is that whilst the black part of the mask hides the layer, grey allows some of the effect of the layer to be seen. It's a little like changing the opacity setting for that part of the layer. If I fill the area of the mask with a darker grey, we see more colour. The darker the grey, the more it blocks the layer from being visible, whilst black blocks it completely. Whenever we add an adjustment layer in Affinity Photo, the mask that's attached to it is always completely white. That's why you see its effect across the entire image. Now that you understand some of the mask basics, let's look at how we can use this. Imagine that we want to increase the saturation in the sky in this image where we can see the glow from the sun on the right. I can do this by adding a vibrance adjustment layer and increasing the saturation slider. Because the layer mask is white, the adjustment affects the entire image, but we don't want that. Let's invert the mask now to turn it black so that it hides the effect. Remember, I just select the mask and press Command and I on my keyboard or Control and I on a Windows PC. By hiding the effect, it allows me to paint it into selected areas by painting on the mask using white. Let's select the paintbrush and set the color to white. I'll then be sure to select the adjustment layers so that I paint on the mask and not the image. As I paint, you can see the adjustment appear. If I display the mask by holding down Option and clicking, you can see the white area that I've now painted. The problem with this though is that it doesn't look very natural. That's because I didn't configure the brush correctly before I started painting. Let's undo the brush strokes and I'll start again. This time I'm going to change the brush from having a hard edge, which is easy to see, to being very soft with a hardness setting of 0%. I'm also going to reduce the flow to 10% rather than 100%. This means the white I paint onto the mask is going to build up more slowly. And because of this, I'll need to use multiple brush strokes, which helps to blend the effect. If we view the mask again, you can see the difference this makes. Also, the effect the layer is having on the image is now much more realistic. But there is another technique you can use which may produce even better results. Let's start again with a new vibrance layer and a black mask. This time, I'll start by selecting the yellow part of the image using the Select Sample Color option in the Select menu. Now I can click on the color in the image that I want to use. I'll pick the area of the cloud on the right near to where the sun is. I can then change the tolerance slider to control what's selected in the image. The higher the value, the wider the range of pixels that are selected. You can see the selection indicated by these marching ants, but that's going to get in the way for the next step. I'll therefore hide these using the View menu and the Show Pixel Selection option. Although I've hidden the marching ants, the selection is still in place. Now I can start to paint on the mask, but I'll be painting through the selection. First though, I'll click the layer to be sure that I'm painting onto the mask. Then I'll paint over the area where I want to boost the saturation. If we look at the mask now, you can see that it's picking out the sampled areas in white. The adjustment layer is now creating a strong but natural adjustment that only targets the colours we want. Now the problem with selections like the one I've been using is that they're only temporary. When we select something else or we close the image, the selection we used vanishes. You could try to recreate it, but you might not sample the same point in the image or use the same settings. Because of this, it's a good idea to save your selections in case you want to use them again in the future. The way you can do this is by adding them as a spare channel in the image. This stores them inside the image so that they're saved as part of it. Let's turn the pixel view back on so you can now see the selection again. I'm then going to select the Channel Studio panel, which is where we can save the selection. If you can't see the Channel Studio panel, you can make it visible in the View Studio menu. The Channel Studio panel shows the channels that make up the entire image. These are the composite red, green, blue, and alpha channels because this is an RGB image. If it was a CMYK image, you'd see those channels instead. Now, as well as the composite channels, we can also view the individual channels of any layer we have selected in the Layers Studio panel. Then further down, we have the pixel selection. This shows the currently selected pixels in the image. To save this selection, all we need to do is right-click on the pixel selection and choose Create Spare Channel. This adds a new spare channel at the bottom of the studio panel, which I can then click to view. I can also right-click on this and select to rename the channel to something more meaningful. This new channel is then saved as part of the image file in case we want to use it in the future. Let's clear the current selection and I'll show you how to use the new channel. All I need to do is right click on it and choose Load to Pixel Selection in the menu. I want you to remember this point because we're going to be coming back to use it later. Now I have the exact same selection active as I did before. I could then paint through it again or I can use it to create a new mask. Watch what happens when I add a new curves adjustment layer to the image. It uses the current selection to create a mask on that layer. Any adjustment I apply then only affects the area allowed by the mask. This also produces a much more realistic adjustment. Remember, selections are temporary, but you can convert them into masks or channels to store them in the image. It's a good idea though to get into the habit of saving your selections as a spare channel. The spare channels are like master templates that you never adjust. Some people use masks for this, but you do sometimes end up editing masks, so it's better to use a spare channel to save your selection. Now earlier I showed you how to load a selection from a spare channel in the Channel Studio panel. Although we used a spare channel, we don't need to limit ourselves like this. We can use any of the channels in the Channels window. Let's right click on the composite red channel and load that instead. Then we'll add another vibrance layer and use that to boost the vibrance of the image. The new layer then has a mask created from the composite red channel. Now our adjustments are affecting areas based on the level of red in the image. If there's a lot of red in that area, the effect is stronger. I'll clear this selection now so that we can edit the mask by painting on it. By painting with black on the mask around the ground, I can restrict the adjustments so that they only affect the sky. Masks are an extremely powerful tool for working with layers, but to get the most out of masks, you need to understand how to create and work with selections. That's the subject of the next lesson. If I've already published that, you'll see it here now and you should watch that next. If not, watch this video where I explain the quick mask mode in Affinity Photo. And if you haven't already done so, don't forget to subscribe and please share this video with other Affinity Photo users. Thanks for watching and I'll see you in the next video.